bright and balmy episode of QI Down by the Briny. Joining me for a saunter down the shore tonight are a supersized strongman, Lou Saunders. A seven stone softy, Sindhu V. A sun kissed stunner, Ed Gamble. Stomping on everyone's sandcastles, Alan Davis! Before we dive in, let's hold our seashells to our ears. Lou goes...
We're all going on a summer holiday.
Sindhu goes...
Sand and sea.
Nice.
Sea and sand.
Ed goes...
Blazing on a sunny afternoon.
Alan goes...
Wow.
I mean, lower the tone. So, these photographic cut-out boards were invented in the 1890s in Cairo. Photographic studios would cut a hole in an actual ancient sarcophagus, right? So that tourists could pose as an ancient Egyptian mummy. And the idea caught on, then eventually they thought, well, we haven't got enough ancient sarcophagi, so we'll make a few fake ones, and then you could be the Sphinx and so on, and the idea took off. This particular photograph is one of my favourites. It shows the Archduke Franz Ferdinand, the one who went on to spark World War I by being assassinated in Sarajevo. Anyway, it's him on holiday in Cairo.
That looks like my dad in a sleeping bag.
The big question, Alan, for you, hats on or hats off?
I keep thinking it's going to fall.
Yeah, it looks nice on you. You look very dapper.
Well, it's very kind.
Very Maurice Chevalier.
And I'm enjoying your sun hat as well.
Yeah, it's going. That's it. Okay.
Can I just say, I've never seen you two flirting before and I really enjoy it.
Do you know, neither of us have been out for a year.
We're wondrous for our relationship.
Anyway, on with the questions. Where in mainland Britain is closest to French soil?
Has Café Rouge got a garden? That's the only place.
I mean, I've driven past. I don't know. Any other guesses?
I'm happy just to say Dover. Come on, let's get it rolling.
OK, so I'm going to give you a clue. French Lieutenant's Woman. Anybody remember where it took place? Lyme Regis. After decades of coastal erosion, washing away all the sand at Lyme Regis, they had to basically rebuild the beaches, and 30,000 tonnes of sand were shipped from northern France. So I guess you could say that the closest bit of French coastline that you can enjoy is in Dorset. First of all, they had to remove groins, all the old groins.
I've had to do that before.
You've had to do that.
What do you mean? There was groins in the sand?
Do you know what a groin is?
I do actually know this from GCSE geography. Oh. It's the barriers all the way along the beach.
Stops the beach getting swept along.
Yeah, it comes from the Latin to grunt. And apparently it used to look like a pig's snout. I don't think so. Do you think so?
What, my groin or...?
I wasn't going to go that low, but...
She was going to keep to here.
Or for me, that high. Then they added shingle to add some ballast to stop the whole beach washing away. And the whole lot was shipped over from northern France, and they thought about lots of different kinds of sand, but it was the wrong colour, it was the wrong size, it was the, you know, everything about it wasn't right. And then they got 6,000 tonnes of Norwegian rock brought over to strengthen the cliffs. And so the town's new seawall is also constructed out of Portuguese and Chinese granite. So it's a Portuguese, Chinese, Norwegian, French seafront.
It would have been great after Brexit if France had just gone, all right then, yeah, we're having Lyme Regis.
We'll have Lyme Regis. Thank you very much. As well as being created, beaches can spontaneously vanish. So there was a violent storm off the coast of County Mayo's Achill Island in 1984, and it washed away the entire beach. There was a 300-metre beach called Dewar Beach, and the local community woke up one morning and it had entirely gone.
What was in its place, though?
Just rocks and pebbles. And it was terrible for tourism. It was just awful. And then in 2017, there was unusual tidal activity, and it all washed washed back again.
No,
oh, it... it all washed back again, and all the jobs started up again, and all the tourism, and then in 2019... Yeah, gone.
No.
In Denmark, yeah. Sometimes the beach is like this and sometimes the beach is like this and you never know which one you're going to get.
Yeah.
And where is David Blaine when this is happening?
Where do they go?
Well, it just erodes and it is a serious problem. In fact, because of it, there's a thing called the Coastal Protection Act 1949, and you're not allowed to take any pebbles or sand from UK beaches.
Oh.
You could be fined £1,000, you could be forced to return all the stuff, because we have to protect them, because, frankly, the ocean's taking enough.
Do you want to have a word with the props manager?
I don't know where.
And also, now, if we need more sand, the French will say no.
But the Italians are even more fierce about it. You can get 6 years in prison. In fact, in 2019, the security services at Cagliari Airport, I think it's called, it's the one in Sardinia, anyway.
Cagliari.
They confiscated 200 kilograms of sand from tourists in a couple of weeks.
Just taking the sand home.
Yeah, like in a container, like as a personal souvenir.
Well, I think we all accidentally take a little bit of sand home.
Yes, but
we?
If it's all of us, you know, and beach gone.
But I just mean, like, if you're going for a swim and there's sand washing around, we're all accidentally smuggling something, aren't we?
Oh, do you mean in your orifices?
Yeah.
Yes. Mm,
in your groin.
How hot are the Italians?
Your pig snouty groin. I've got loads of sand.
I'm sorry, Paolo, I took some sand home in my snout.
But what is really amazing, if you look at sand samples under a microscope, look at the variety of materials and shapes that it comes in. So when you look at sand, it looks quite sort of homogenous to the naked eye.
Yeah, it does.
Don't you think that's it's like a cheese board? But you can see detail within the tiny particles. It's amazing, isn't it?
Nature is quite good in the end.
And if you take nothing else away with you, take that thought. Yeah. What are the main problems with living in a sandcastle?
You get too much sand in your lululala.
In your lululala? It's lululala and groins, that's where we're going. I like lululala. Did your mother call it that?
No, the kids came up with it.
Lululala?
Lululala, and they would run around saying lululala, lululala, and then my mother started singing it one day in the kitchen, lululala. I was like, no, that's not... No,
we don't sing that.
No, we don't. That, just don't.
So there's going to be one, is there? A real one?
What, a real problem?
A real sandcastle. Like a livable with rooms and...
We may get to that, but first of all, we're talking about creatures that live in sandcastles.
What?
I know! There are sandcastle worms, OK?
Oh.
Yeah. They are called, and I probably will mispronounce this, Phragmatopoma californica. So they live along the Californian coast. And they live their entire life in castles made of sand, which they build themselves.
Oh.
They are fantastic. So the picture on the left there, that is a single sandworm. And the tentacles that it's got on its head, that's those things you can see that are sticking out like that, they sort through grains of sand. And so they select ones that are the suitable size. And then they secrete a compound from their body, which honestly, it's a sort of underwater glue. So then these other pictures are a whole lot of them. Each little hole, each little tube is a single sandworm. And then they all live together.
Wow.
Yes, wow, I know, right? What's important... Thank you. What's important for us is that this cement that they secrete, it's like an underwater glue, and it might be that it has amazing medical applications. It might be the sort of thing that can glue bones back together instead of using metal pins.
I tried to get worms once.
You tried to actually get them?
Yeah.
To make yourself lose weight?
Yeah.
OK.
And I put a piece of raw meat on my bum.
A bacon wrapped in bacon.
What was it, darling?
Nothing happened.
So no, what was the meat?
I can't remember. I was only about 11.
Chop. Was it a chop?
Oh, a lovely lamb chop on the bot.
It's interesting.
You'd hope so, wouldn't you?
It's interesting to know, Lou, that you're vegan, but your bottom isn't.
Yes. Do you know, in the Tour de France, years and years ago, before they had lots of sort of medical things and so on, the gentleman on the Tour de France used to put a stake down their trousers to stop it rubbing, right, when they were bicycling, and then it was fully tenderised when they got there, and then they'd cook it in their
supper. No. Oh. No.
That's my gift to you.
Wow.
You'd
have to keep an eye on it, wouldn't you, to make sure you got your steak back.
Yes,
again.
You wouldn't want your friend's steak, would you?
Oh, boy.
From your friend's lululala. that's not.
Yeah.
Anyway, each of these worms is about, they're about an inch long, and they live in tunnels about 6 inches long, but they can live in a city, oh. and they're amazing. They're constructed on the shore. And so what happens is they're underwater at high tide, but they're exposed at low tide. So during low tide, they kind of hunker down and they seal up because they don't want anything to get them. But when it's high tide, they pop their head out with these oh. lovely little tentacles and fish. They go fishing for microscopic food that's happening past and grab grains of sand to improve the home. What do you think the main problem these worms might have, given that they never leave the tunnel and they always face outwards?
Is it going to the loo?
Yes, darling. It's
so they gradually fill up their tunnel?
They would. If they just defecated, it would just be full of poo.
So they don't defecate?
No, they do, but it's so clever, OK? It's the sort of thing a little boy goes, oh, I want to do that, OK? They have a rectum at the end of the body, like most animals, but there's a long tube, comes halfway up the body, it poos on its own back, and then it simply shrugs the fecal pellet up its body and out the tube.
I'm quite envious of any creature that can come up with a pellet like that.
Yeah.
I'd love to have a fecal pellet.
Yeah.
It would transform lavatory design, wouldn't it? Because
yeah.
it would be more like Marble Run or something
yeah.
like that.
You could have some fun with it, couldn't you?
You could just launch it off.
Yeah.
Do you think you could teach yourself to fire it and maybe set targets up in the bathroom?
Well, I think after a while there's bound to be competitive pelleting,
yeah.
isn't it?
Yeah. And dare to dream.
How far can it go, though?
They are astonishingly interesting. So some squirt sperm up into the water and some squirt eggs up into the water and larvae are created. And then what happens is they can smell the very cement that holds the sandcastle city together and they go back to where they came from.
Sandy, do you think nature's actually quite good in the end as well?
I'll be honest, Lou, I'm coming round to it. I am. There is a human who lives in a sandcastle and his name is Marcio Matolias. He's also known in Rio de Janeiro as King Marcio. And he's a sand sculptor. He makes his money from tourists and also from a used bookshop, which he runs from a 3-square-metre castle that has been his home for over 20 years.
And it's made of sand?
It's made of sand. That's his... where he lives. He lives inside that sand castle. His main problems are the elements, so his castle can collapse if there's a very heavy storm. It gets unbearably hot in the summer. He's got no toilet and he hasn't got a tube. You know, he hasn't, can't do the thing. So he has to go to the fire station if he wants to.
And they're all right with that, are they?
Apparently, it costs $1 each time he goes. I don't know why.
Well, he's saving a lot on rent, I suppose.
He's lived rent-free for more than 20 years, which is...
Yeah. Doesn't the sea wash it away?
The trick is to build it above the tide mark.
Right.
It's in the lay-by off the A4.
Yeah. I'd worry about bullies coming and kicking it down.
Well, it's funny that you should say that, because probably the very first reference to a sandcastle being kicked over, arguably in the Iliad, which is the 7th century BC. Homer described Apollo, god of the sun, demolishing a Greek stockade and compared it to a child kicking over a sand sculpture. So we haven't really matured, have we, darling? Anyway, we thought we'd get you to make your own sandcastle or sand sculpture. So you've each got a tray of sand. Here we are, like this. And there's a bucket of water you'll need as
yes.
well. Okay, it needs to be really wet. That is the thing. Have you not got a bucket of water?
Yeah, well, I don't really want to get messy.
Oh, I see.
I quite like a prissy child. I took my daughter out, she was 7. The whole class, we all went and had burgers. And there was a little boy who was very particular, and I said, do you want a burger, darling? He said, I wonder if the chef might do a salad. So that's it. So you, yes, oh, Cinder's doing fine work here.
I'm just going to tip all mine in there.
Oh,
actually.
You're just going to go crazy for it. Yeah. But apparently the wetter it is, and so the guy who lives in the sandcastle on the beach in Rio has to keep wetting it, otherwise it collapses.
Oh, no.
What?
Mine looks like rather a nice doll.
Does it feel nice? Does it feel like a
all
nice
I'm trying
thing?
To do is get all my there, sand yeah, in the bucket.
Relaxing. Right.
But I think I made mine too wet.
Oh, a bit too... Cindy's doing very well.
Well, I mean, I am from the country of Taj Mahal. I
yes.
have a lot to live up to here.
And I go to Brighton now and again, so a lot of pressure on me as well.
OK. There's...
Oh, it just looks like my bucket's got the shit.
Oh. Was it not coming out now?
It looks like it didn't make it to the fire station. He's put a bucket over it. Oh, no, no.
Right, I think, let's have a look. So, do you want to describe what you've made here?
Well, it's a house in which there's some really nice parents that live on this floor.
Right.
And they've had a fight.
Oh.
So now they're building two separate houses.
Wow, it's like a soap opera.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry, mine, can I just ask, Sindhu, how's your marriage? Is it all right?
I've been married 23 years, Lou. No one is going anywhere now.
Ed, what have you made, my darling?
Mine is a satirical piece about climate change.
Yes, it looks like a breast implant.
It's also a breast implant.
A breast implant. Yes. OK. Oh, Alan, you got it out the bucket.
Creating a mezzanine level.
OK, lovely. Ooh, and Lou, do you want to describe yours?
It's just sort of classic piece, really. Mm. Oh, hang on.
Yep. Oh, that's it. Yeah. I think I'm going to lose the winner. Lose the winner. Sandcastles away, shall we? My favourite childhood memory was building sandcastles with my grandfather until my mum took the urn from me. I'm here all week. Where would you slip on this swish ensemble?
That's where it went. OK.
Well, not on the beach, judging by how pale the model is.
Yes, darling.
In the olden days, over here on the beach.
Yes, exactly. That is
really?
A woman's wool bathing suit. Yeah. It actually dates from the 1870s in the United States. But women in the 19th century were expected to bathe in full-length dresses, gowns made of thick material that didn't become transparent when wet. And they quite often used to have weights in the hem. They didn't want it to float up, right? There's no question of having a dress on and then it suddenly goes up like that. So you've got weights and woolen material.
How many women just drowned from that?
Thousands.
Yes, thousands. All of that changed in the 1900s. There was a wonderful woman called Annette Kellerman. She was an Australian swimmer. She became one of the very first women to publicly wear a one-piece bathing suit. This is not a picture of Annette Kellerman. This is women having their suits measured to see if they were allowed to be on the beach.
And that's
you can see why they weren't allowed that, because it is very erotic.
Quite so risque, isn't it? Well, Annette Kellerman, the very first time she appeared in 1907 on a beach in Massachusetts wearing a one-piece suit, she was arrested for public indecency. The judge was very sweet about it. He said, yes, I can see it's more comfortable for swimming. So after that, she had to wear a cape to the edge of the shore.
The guy you've got to watch out for is the guy who volunteers to measure the swimming.
To do the measuring. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It's Alan. It's got the same hat, Alan.
All right, I'll do it.
She's a really interesting woman, Annette Kellerman. She's really worth looking at. She was born in 1887 and she suffered from rickets as a child, and so she was sent to have swimming lessons in order to improve. It was kind of physiotherapy. And she was so good at it that she started appearing in competitions and giving performances in Melbourne. She would dress as a mermaid and swim with fish in an aquarium. I mean, it's a living.
Oh,
is that really? Her?
That's her, yeah. Isn't that extraordinary?
Wow.
She became a movie star, actually, in the United States. She performed all her own stunts. She once dove 60 foot into a pool full of crocodiles.
Oh.
She was the very first person to appear nude in a Hollywood movie. This is her in a movie called A Daughter of the Gods. It was made in 1916. It was the very first film that cost $1 million.
Wow.
It took 20,000 people to make this film. It took 8 months, and we don't have a copy of it anymore.
Oh.
But isn't she beautiful?
Yeah.
She's
not,
you see, just that frame is the guy with his measuring stick going, I'm not sure this is regulation.
No, I don't think it's any good. The modern bikini, any idea when that turns up? When do we first get the bikini?
60s?
No, earlier than that, 46.
Oh.
This is not actually a bikini. This is called the Atom. So this is the French designer Jacques Haim, and he designed the Atom, which is this one, advertises the world's smallest bathing suit. And then a man called Louis Réard said his would be smaller than the world's smallest bathing suit, and he called it the bikini after the bikini atoll. So it's all to do with the atomic bomb that they were experimenting with. Nuclear tests were done on the bikini atoll. So bikini just means coconut place in Marshallese.
Do you know, this particular bikini reminds me that when I was 8 years old, I came home from school and my mother was serving us lunch in a bikini. And we said, well, why are you wearing a bikini? She said, because I can't wear it outside. It's not modest. It's so beautiful, so I'll just wear it in the house. So she just wore her bikini all day. And then when my dad got home, she changed. And I said, why didn't you wear a bikini? She said, because it's very immodest. He will have a shock and heart attack.
And we were like, oh, we don't want that.
What a secret weapon to have.
But it was
and enough of you.
Exactly. But it was exactly like that, you know?
Frilly bikinis.
Yep, polka-dotted frilly bikini.
Well, let's have another question. How do Germans spoil your Spanish holiday?
By showing up. They always want to hog the places.
Has some research been done and it turns out it was us?
Yes,
yeah,
it's part of the truth. It's to do with Mr. Hitler. It's to do with Mr. Hitler and why the Germans spoil your Spanish holiday. So he is responsible for the fact that you have to change your watch every time you travel between Britain and Spain. What happened was, in 1942, General Franco, he switched Spain from Greenwich Mean Time to Central European Time to match Berlin's clocks in solidarity with Hitler and bumped the whole country forward an hour. And the result is that Spain is not in its natural time zone.
Not the worst thing that Hitler's done.
No. No, darling. No. That's fair. So the one that would maximise the amount of sunlight during the day is not the zone that Spain is in. There are many parts of Spain that are west of Greenwich, and yet it's an hour ahead. And so during the summer on the west coast of Spain, the sun is directly overhead at 20 to 3 in the afternoon, which makes no sense at all.
Would he mind if we put it back?
Well, I don't know why they don't. It just would make sense, wouldn't it?
Call me.
Call you now. Put Lou in charge. Now, the idea that Sindhu first came up with, the idea that the Germans might hog the sun loungers by getting up early and placing the towels upon them, is not true. It is something that has been lodged in the British psyche since 1993, and it's due to a Carling Black Label ad. They ran an ad where a British person threw a towel from his room to a lounger and it skimmed across the pool like a bouncing bomb to the theme of the Dam Busters. So the Germans are very upset that this continues to be a thing. So in 2014, they did an investigation, Bild newspaper, into it, and they claimed, according to their observations in Spanish resorts, the British are by far the largest culprits for doing this. Though when they interviewed one British holidaymaker, they insisted, it's the French. Right. Who invented sunbathing?
I don't know much trivia, but...
I thought that was it. I know nothing.
I know nothing, yeah. But my mother said once, she said, you must go to school with an umbrella because you're very dark. Sunbathing is only allowed by the lady who would do it. She was Coco Chanel. Coco Chanel, she could do sunbathing because she was so fair, not like you, over dark. Take the umbrella. So I had to go to school with an umbrella. Yeah.
Well, it is often thought that Coco Chanel invented sun tanning, but in fact, she didn't really originate it.
It was a Sun newspaper.
It was the Sun newspaper, yes, that decided it was the thing. There's a wealthy American socialite couple called Gerald and Sarah Murphy. This is a wonderful picture of Gerald and Sarah on the left and Cole Porter, who's one of their friends, and a woman called Genevieve Carpenter, who just seems to be there to hold Cole up. And they went to the French Riviera in the 1920s, and they became famous as party and holiday hosts. Up until then, people had only gone to the Riviera in the winter, and they persuaded the Hotel du Cap to remain open for the summer, and everybody came. So Zelda and F. Scott Fitzgerald, Ernest Hemingway, Pablo Picasso, Dorothy Parker, Cole Porter in the picture there. And they invented the idea of beach time and sunbathing. They used to get everybody to come for picnics and they used to start games on the beach. It's a weird thing. It had never happened before. People had gone to the beach to go swimming, but they hadn't thought, and we'll just stop for a bit. Why was it unfashionable before then to have a tan? Why do you think that was?
Because it showed you worked outside.
Yeah, that you had what could only be described as a lower class job. You worked outdoors. Yeah. Anyway, Coco Chanel is worth talking about because she's often said to have sort of single-handed... There she is on the left. She came back from a Mediterranean cruise in...
Crazy Coco.
Crazy. Came back with a tan in 1923 from a cruise and everybody went crazy for it. But she's really probably just putting the icing on what was already chic, and it was chic because of the woman on the right. This is the world's first female global sports celebrity.
Oh.
She was a tennis player called Suzanne Lenglen. And she played in short sleeves. I mean, look at that. In 1919, she had a deep tan. She was the only female player to serve overarm. She drank cognac between sets. I know. And she won 241 titles during her career. So if you think, you know, at this very moment, Serena Williams has got 98 titles. Suzanne Lenglen, 241. And part of the reason why Wimbledon is where it is now is that the former courts, which were on a place called Warple Road, could not cope with the number of fans who came to see her. I know, she's amazing. And then tanned skin became all the rage. Right, now, I want you to imagine you're all at sea. Would you prefer the screw or the paddle?
Who's on the boat?
The screw.
You're going to go to screw?
Yeah.
I'll take the paddle.
You'll take the paddle?
Yeah.
Paddle. Screw is correct. So, we are talking about ships. After the Napoleonic Wars, Britain was, I mean, undoubtedly the world's foremost naval superpower. But you're still talking about wooden ships propelled by sails. And then passenger ships began to move towards steel, and they began to move towards being steamships. And the Navy soon followed, and the question was, which was going to be the best for these boats? Was it going to be the paddle on either side or the screw propellers? So they had a tug of war, I love this, between two virtually identical ships, wow. HMS Rattler, which had a propeller, and HMS Electo, which, as you can see on the right there, had a pair of paddle wheels. 1845, they tie them together with a rope, they're set to full power, no contest, absolutely none. The Rattler, boom, backwards. She pulled Electo at 2.7 knots, and the screw propeller after that tug of war became the standard way to propel naval ships. In fact, you can see the propeller itself, if you're a geek like myself, on display at the SS Great Britain Museum in Bristol. And so then they started doing the same with electric trains and steam trains, having tug-of-war competitions to see which was better. Which do you think is better, electric train or a steam train?
Better in what sense?
Stronger.
Oh.
It might be a steam train.
I'd like it to be.
Could be an electric train.
You could give the steam train a head start and still you would be able to pull it backwards.
But a steam train will always sound better. Electric trains are so utilitarian, whereas steam trains are
Yeah,
and you can cook your breakfast on a shovel. That's what I always like about a steam train. They can't do that on a circuit board, can you?
No.
No.
Do they clean the shovel first?
No, these are working men. They eat a sooty egg now and again. Who cares?
Yeah. Now, where's the one place you're guaranteed not to meet a shark?
Claire's Accessories.
What's that? Oh, he's jumping into a shark.
Into a shark. What a way to die. And look at his arm. He's just had his COVID jab. It's not fair, is it?
I'm free!
OK, so there is a particular type of shark. Where would you not expect? You would not expect it in Claire's Accessories.
Dry land.
You would not expect it on dry land. Well, there is a particular shark known as the epaulette shark. Its real name is Hemiscillium ocellatum. And it's named because if you look on the shoulder, it looks like it's almost got a military epaulette.
And that can get out, can it, and walk about?
Well, you find them off the coast of Australia, you find them off the coast of New Guinea, but you also find them on the coast. They're about 2-3 foot long, and they use their tail and their pectoral fins to shimmy along the seabed. So have a look at them underwater and see them moving along. I think it's just very slightly creepy.
Oh.
Doom, doom, doo 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 doom.
Isn't it weird?
They don't come out of the water, do they?
Yes. So they are also able to crawl out of water and over the sand to access tidal pools. So this is an epaulette shark walking on land.
Oh, you wouldn't want that.
You wouldn't want that coming at you, would you? No.
How far can they come up the beach? Are they going to like get in your car and stuff?
Yes. There's nothing they like better than to drive a hire car.
And suddenly they speed down to the water's edge, and 20 more of them get in. Come on, boys! A few donuts, and then bugger off into the town.
No, they don't go that far out because they want tidal pools. So they eat worms and small fish and crustaceans. They find them by shoving their heads into the sand, and then they filter the food out like that through the gills. The result is they can become stranded in rock pools overnight, but they can withstand severe oxygen deprivation by basically putting the body into a standby mode. The good thing is, darling, if one came towards you, they have very little interest in humans.
And they didn't look very big.
No,
I mean, just punch one in the face.
Yeah, they might give you a little nip if you accidentally trod on one, but so would I. The place you're definitely going to find a shark is an area of the Pacific Ocean called the Great White Shark Cafe. You don't like sharks, you know?
I love sharks, but it's still scary.
It is quite scary. In 2002, scientists at Stanford University found out that sharks go to this particular spot in the Pacific Ocean. They go there every single year. Nobody could work out why. It seemed to be a sort of virtual desert as far as shark food was concerned. And it turns out that there is food there, but it is much deeper than our satellites can see. And these light-sensitive animals, things like squid and phytoplankton, small fish, they live in an area just below where the light can penetrate. And a scientist at Monterey Bay Aquarium, Salvador Jørgensen, says it's the largest migration of animals on Earth, but it's a vertical migration that's timed with the light cycle. And we didn't even know it was happening.
Wow.
I know. It's amazing. To point out one further place that you are likely to find sharks, this is alongside bikini pageants in trashy movies. OK, this is a much understudied genre, right? Super Shark, OK, as an example. An offshore drilling accident releases a giant primordial shark threatening to turn a bikini contest into a bloodbath. It has that fantastic strap line, bikinis, bullets and big bites.
Before we all start laughing, this was my directorial debut and I had a lot to learn.
Can you see on this picture there are bikinis but they're like behind the shark? Like, they are there. And then there's avalanche sharks, which was made in 2013. A major avalanche on a ski resort wakes a prehistoric snow shark that was buried deep under the snow, threatening a bikini competition.
OK.
Yeah, both of these films, if you're thinking of watching them incidentally, are rated as one star.
Out of 1,000 stars!
Has anybody ever seen a shark and bikini movie in that genre?
I've seen one where the sharks have learnt to come onto the land. So I think it's called sand sharks. They swim under the sand and then leap up and kill mainly women in bikinis.
Mainly. Hang on a second. What's that? Over there! In the water! Circling ominously! Oh my God, it's... General ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. I've said it a lot over the years, I just try to make it a bit more exciting. What's this puffed up puffer fish full of?
Sand.
Poison.
It is full of poison. What else?
Yeah.
Is it seawater, Sandy?
Is it seawater? Yes, it is. They inflate themselves by swallowing water from around them into their stomach, which inflates them.
A bit like me when I learned to swim.
And then its eye. Its eye and its mouth. And then what's happened to the rest of it? I think it's lost its arms and legs. It's completely evolutionised down to really the basics.
It's really saying, go away, I'm terribly frightening.
Should have seen me a million years ago. I was amazing. And this is all that's left.
It's got no rib cage and it's got
it's amazing.
Elastic skin.
And when they let themselves go, do they go...
They fly backwards. They're through the ocean.
Here we go! And then they're just a tiny, like an old sock with a massive eye.
But why would you have to burp a puffer fish?
Burp it as in like a baby?
Yeah, like, you know.
Oh, to show it you care.
So if they inhale while they're out of water, they can get air in and they can't get rid of it themselves. And they'll be stranded floating upside down. So, for example, if you're trying to get them from one tank to another, for a brief moment they're out of the water, they may get air in their system and you have to help them or they'll die. So you have to burp the puffer fish and basically you have to hold its head underwater and then just gently squeeze the stomach.
You could put it under your colleague's pillow on his seat as a bit of a prank.
Nature's whoopee cushion.
I love that. You said poison, did you not? Yeah, famously contains an extremely potent tetrodotoxin. It is the second most poisonous vertebrate on the planet, second only to the poison dart frog. And sharks are the only creatures that are immune to their toxin, so a shark can eat one whole. Anyway, it's not the fish that produces this poison, it's the bacteria that lives inside it. And rather famously, the Japanese delicacy, which is called fugu, requires specialist preparation to render the puffer fish safe. And as a consequence, because it hospitalises about 50 people a year, the Japanese emperor is banned from eating it. About a half dozen people die in a typical year.
I think it'd be quite easy just not to eat it.
Just not have it?
Yeah.
I've never tried it. I believe it's delicious. And apparently they did try and make some non-poisonous puffer fish by breeding them without the bacteria being present, but it just didn't taste the same. Isn't that the strangest thing? And you have to be careful. It's found in the liver, the ovaries, the eyes and the skin. I mean, it's a big workaround for a chef, isn't it?
You know, delicacies, what can you say?
I know, right. What could you drink if you were shipwrecked on an untouched Caribbean island?
Sunny!
Yes, Ed!
coconuts.
No, why not? Why no? Why?
It's untouched. It has to be touched.
That is correct. You could not drink coconut milk or coconut water because coconut trees, palm trees, are from Asia and they are not found naturally in the Caribbean. It's an invasive species. It competes with local trees. They suck up the water. They don't really provide much nesting for birds. They damage the soil. Leaves are not nutritious to native animals. And although coconuts can drift from one island to another, there are no currents to get them from the Pacific to the Caribbean without human help. So it came because it was a way of taking water on board ships. Was to take coconuts with you. But they are wonderful coconuts because in the one thing you get this high-calorie food, you get drinking water, you get a shell that you can turn into charcoal to cook on, you get fibre that you can turn into rope, you can use the whole thing to act as a float if you're in the sea, you know. And you're,
you can disguise a bear as a lady.
Yes.
Yeah. Horse noises.
They are terrific for horse noises.
I mean, for years and years, there would have been people playing with coconuts who'd never seen a horse.
Yeah.
And then one day, horses turn up.
Yeah.
Let's say these animals can do an amazing impression of a coconut.
The Mutiny on the Bounty actually was triggered because Captain Bligh accused the crew of stealing coconuts. I mean, they're really valuable and beautiful things. Where is the world's longest mountain range?
It's underwater.
Yes!
Alan, you used to be the silly one on this show.
Yeah, and then you lot turned up.
You never would have got that series one.
You're absolutely right. It's the Mid-Oceanic Ridge. It's an enormous system of underwater mountains. It's pretty much everywhere if you look at that. It's the Arctic through the Atlantic to the Antarctic, Indian and Pacific Oceans, and that all links up together. It's about 40,000 miles long. So if you think about, you know, one of the great mountain ranges that we can see, the Andes, that's about 4,300 miles. This is 40,000 miles, and it zigzags across the entire planet. It looks like the globe's had a terrible accident, doesn't it?
Yeah, or a massive railway.
If we could see it, it'd be the most prominent topographic feature on the Earth's surface.
What, so what's really the point, though? You know what I mean?
What's the point of an underwater mountain?
Yeah, what's it up to?
Are you not enjoying nature anymore, though?
No, come on, I just think, come on. Let's have a look at you.
You pull the plug out, amazing. Yeah.
So an enormous amount of tectonic activity happens along this ridge. It's really important. There was a woman oceanographer called Marie Tharp. She was an American. And she discovered the ridge. She discovered it in 1952, despite not being allowed to go to sea on any of the expeditions.
Wow.
So the Navy rules were men only. So what she did was she took all the measurements that the men brought back from sea, and she said, this is her own words, I had a blank canvas to fill with extraordinary possibilities. It was a once-in-a-lifetime, a once-in-the-history-of-the-world opportunity for anyone, but especially for a woman in the 1940s. And every time she mapped out the measurements, she found this huge rift in the middle of the ocean. Mm. And all her colleagues said it was just girl talk and it was nonsense. What's the point, basically? And then they realised that it was the Earth's largest physical feature. And she did all this sitting at a desk and not out at sea. It is an enormously important discovery. We know almost nothing about the world's biggest mountain range, but what we do know we owe to Marie Tharp. Right. Step right up. What does this machine test?
Strength.
Kinetic energy.
Oh, no, I like that.
I don't know what that is, Ed.
He has turned very clever.
He has.
I just said the words. I don't know what it is. Don't worry.
It's a traditional fairground or pier attraction. It's known as the high striker, the strongman game, strength tester. It's actually a test of accuracy, OK? Oh. The key is to maximise the force exerted on the mechanism by hitting the exact centre of the impact button flatly and squarely with the mallet.
Ah.
So there's a website called The Art of Manliness. And it recommends using the same action as for splitting wood with an axe. Now, you should have a mallet. So, now, what we thought we'd do is that we'd get you to have a go, and then we'll add the points that you gather on the machine to your score for the show today. OK? Who wants to go first?
I'll go first.
You're up.
Go on,
OK.
Then. Right.
go and try it out. Now, it is possible that this game is not rigged, the one we're showing you, but they may have been rigged in the past. So sometimes they would set it to an easy mode and somebody weak-looking would come along and strike the bell with ease.
Right. Whack it, Ed. Whack it.
Whoa. Oh, oh, it's 70.
Oh, that was 100, surely.
No, 70.
OK.
Is it fun?
Not, like, loads of fun, I'd say.
Right, Sindhu, you're going to have a go?
Well done.
So, when they rigged it, they would set it to easy and some weak guy would hit the bell and then a big, strong bloke would say, oh, I can do that, if that weak guy can do it, and then they'd set it to hard and he'd get, like, an embarrassing low score and then the men would all be pumped up and want to have a go.
Come on, Sindhu.
What'd you get?
A generous 50, I'd
say. A 50. We're going to say 50. Well done, darling. Congratulations. Right, Lou.
Take a run up.
Tell her.
Oh, you missed it completely! You're an actual menace.
Here
you go. Super Lou.
Good. Again,
good.
Wow, worse.
Yeah, no, no. Okay, Alan,
add them together.
Yes, 40. 40 will give you 40. Yeah.
It couldn't have been. It wasn't 40.
Okay.
10.
A 50.
60.
50. I'm going to give you 50.
Thanks, Andy.
So, in... I don't hit things professionally.
Oh, but, go on, give it a whack, son. It's very satisfying.
Guy, will you hit it
is,
for me?
It is very satisfying.
Guy, will you give it a go? Come on. Come and do this. This is Guy with us. He's got this.
Come on,
go on, Guy.
Go on, Guy. You've got this.
Come on, Guy.
Oh, ba-ba!
Oh, well done, Guy. I love that. Well,
I smell a rat, a stinking rat.
Wow. It looks like the sun's going down. So we better call it a day, pack up the deck chairs and take a look at the scores. In last place, all at sea, it's Sindhu with 42. Next with 45 points, it's Lou. With 53 points, it's Ed. Points, it's Alan. Taking top prize tonight with 100 points, it's floor manager extraordinaire Guy Smart.
What?
Thank you to Sindhu, Ed, Lou, and Alan. And I leave you with this observation by American motivational speaker Bob Moed. You can't leave footprints in the sands of time if you're sitting on your butt. And who wants to leave butt prints in the sands of time? Good night.